9:15, ladies and gentlemen. It's time for the EA press conference. Well, almost time. It's time for our pre-show, and I'm Chris Waters here to host it along with this fine panel of GameSpot extraordinarios.
Aww.
That's a word. Mm-hmm. Alexa Ray Correa.
Hi.
Hi, welcome. Glad to have you here.
Yeah, excited.
E3 and so hard. Lucy James.
Hello.
And Rob Crossley.
Round two.
Round two. Mm-hmm. Rob, you and I, we talked about Microsoft. We caught a little bit of EA games in the Microsoft press conference, but right now we're going to delve into what we want to see from EA, what we hope to see, what we know we're not going to see, and EA Access. We're going to talk about that a lot. Maybe. I don't know. let's talk with one of the games that you see when you enter E3, Star Wars Battlefront. It's plastered in like a bunch of different places.
Everywhere. Yep.
It's obviously a big one for EA this year with the release of the Star Wars movie and Battlefront's release coming later this year. We got a look at it during Star Wars Celebration a few months ago, but only a very small look at gameplay. They got to come big with this one.
Yeah, so the gameplay, as far as I'm concerned, never got released publicly, did it?
Correct.
And you were there. You got to see it. You were in the
exclusive
club.
There was actual gameplay. It wasn't just a trailer. I promise.
It was real. So I think they're going to hit hard and fast with a lot of gameplay. Probably going to be the multiplayer. How many people did they say they can get? It's like
32, I believe, is the cap, which certainly not the highest a Battlefield game has reached. And that's
not the
sort
lofty heights of
the comparison that people reach for. But yeah, 32 players, and you know they. When they show off a game like this, it's always it's got to be choreographed to some degree, right? Because if you had someone actually playing in a live multiplayer match, no one wants to watch someone die during a press conference.
Yeah. No, although I do love it sometimes in press conferences where they do that, and you see someone like quickly teabag someone else just off screen, and then they get back to the demo.
I've never seen that actually. Does that happen?
Yeah, that's happened.
Teabag radar is not on point.
My teabag radar's off.
So here we see the AT-AT being destroyed, and AT-AT, the sort of walker battle is one of, or walker assault is one of the modes they've announced for Star Wars Battlefront. There was a lot of speculation from myself and other people who saw the demo as to, you know, whether the AT-AT would be pilotable, to what extent vehicles are going to be pilotable. You know, obviously we saw people riding around in snow speeders here and in speeder bikes. On the forest moon of Endor, we got to see some vehicles, right, guys?
So they have announced that we can pilot these, and I think that we can pilot the Millennium Falcon.
Yes,
really?
Yeah. I believe there we see the Millennium Falcon right there at the end. It's like a hero character. So just the way you can, you could play as Darth Vader, you could play as Yoda. I think the Millennium Falcon is going to be like a hero vehicle that spawns in when certain conditions are met or something like that.
I know this sounds a little bit weird, but I don't want it to be. I don't want them to do too much. I don't want them to overreach. I don't want it to be too ambitious. I think when you looked at the Fallout 4 presentation yesterday, it was trying to do a bit too much, perhaps.
Really?
I think so. I think it
was
too ambitious.
You're the only person who's said anything bad about
Fallout. No, don't show me that much.
I thought it was amazing. Don't get me wrong. Okay. I thought it was amazing. It's just that they were trying to do everything and show everything at the same time, and I don't want this to do the same thing. I would like to see some focus, basically.
There is something to be said for clarity of presentation, giving people something that they, like, you get really excited about, but also that you can kind of wrap your head around and not, you know, it doesn't, like, the thing you get excited about doesn't lose its luster by being compared to, like, oh, I also have to remember this thing and this part about the game.
You don't
and
have
that
to
stuff.
Think too hard about it. Just enjoy it.
Exactly. Yeah. I don't want to think too hard.
Video games.
So Battlefront certainly going to be making a big showing. And we did not see Battlefront during Microsoft's press conference.
Nope,
and this
nope.
is kind of a question we touched on in our pre-show earlier. Platform exclusivity, any kind of like angling for early maps, any kind of like we're the lead platform on this. That's been a game that Xbox, that Microsoft and Sony have played for years now with Call of Duty, with Destiny. Right now, it sort of feels like Sony's sort of edging out Microsoft, especially with the absence of.
Well, we know for a fact that Microsoft definitely doesn't have it.
The force is strong with PlayStation, apparently, according to the banners outside the convention center.
Very true.
So I think it's fair to say that's where we're going to be seeing it. Mm-hmm. Or at least I expect we're going to get some kind of gameplay reveal at EA, and then there's going to be a big splash at Sony.
Big splash at Sony. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So do you think? Yeah. But EA also wants to do their thing, and so we're going to see that Star Wars Battlefront in a big way. There's also a lingering question of another Star Wars project that may be in the works at EA.
Well, last year Amy Hennig, Uncharted writer, left Naughty Dog and is now at Visceral working on an unannounced Star Wars game with Todd Stashwick, the actor. And we have heard nothing from it so far. I really want to know what it is. there's a lot of speculation on their Instagram accounts. They were tweeting pictures of their office and stuff, and I guess there were Han Solo references in every picture. So there's some speculation that it's a Han Solo game.
Was that the one they tweeted when Nolan North was there? Am I imagining this?
I can't.
This was a dream you had, wasn't it?
No.
Nolan North was there.
No, I have an image in my head of they had like some actor with them, and they were like kind
was
of tweeting.
Was it the Stashwick guy?
It might have been Stashwick.
But I mean, Amy's a great writer. I think the Uncharted, the first year Uncharted's were excellent. I'm excited to see what she does with Star Wars. Mm-hmm.
Do you think it'll be shown today, though?
I don't know. They've been so quiet on it, and I think they started working on it last year, so I would sort of be...
Yeah, last year's pretty soon.
Yeah, I think it might be too soon to see it. Maybe, I would guess, given the weight given to Star Wars Celebration now that the new movies are coming out, that game will probably be announced at Celebration next year. That's my guess.
I think that's great.
Unless they do what they did last year with, like, you know, Mass Effect, where they just had the guys in a darkened room, and they were saying that, you know... We are working on something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We really love Mass Effect. Gosh, isn't Mass Effect a great universe to
Mass
build in?
Mass Effect.
We love making Mass Effect games. Do you think...
Wistfully.
So, what do you think, Lucy? Mass Effect going to be making an appearance at
it
the press conference?
It has to. I'm afraid it has to. I also think that Microsoft showing Mass Effect as an old 360 title that you can now play on Xbox One, that is not a coincidence.
Oh, a little tip
obviously,
of the hat.
Obviously,
to,
Microsoft published the original game. Mm-hmm. So I like to think they are just unconsciously priming us for a reveal today. Yeah. And I really hope so. I've seen a couple of members of the BioWare team actually tweeting, like, I'm off to EA, E3.
Oh, really?
So you're like, what are you doing here? What have you been working on, pal?
Okay, so signs are good. We're going to see some Mass Effect. Then becomes a question, what do you want to see? What are we... If it's
more
not, what are we going to
see?
More alien sex, for sure.
I went there.
But, like... You know, because that universe is so rich. There's so many aliens and so much sex. but
relationships. But I think,
So is it going to be Shepard again or a totally new protagonist, totally new story?
Shepard's story's done.
I think this will be a total refresh. New story, new protagonist, new setting, new everything.
New era. You know, it's not going to be sort of the Reaper battle necessarily.
Look at this.
Wow, that was fast footage of
our production
alien sex.
Our
production
staff
team
is top
amazing.
Notch. They have all this stuff. Bookmarked.
So I think with Mass Effect, so Dragon Age Inquisition had that leak about a year before it came out, and all of the things pretty much in that leak turned out to be accurate.
That survey leak.
Mass Effect has similarly had a survey leak.
Yeah, there was that.
And from the sounds of it, they're making basically Battlestar Galactica the game, and I am so ready for that.
Really?
You guys are amazing. Thank you, GameSpot production team.
Wow.
That's
what I think about when I think of a Battlestar and Mass Effect cross-up. It's like a good visualization of how wonderful that would be.
Yeah.
So, of course, the Battlestar premise is, you know, an armada desperately trying to, like, escape, trying to go somewhere. Like, in Mass Effect, you're hopping around, you're sort of exploring, going planet to planet. Mm-hmm. But you're coming back to the Citadel. That kind of game would be sort of a fundamentally different structure to that Mass Effect world, you know, that a different impetus to drive the story.
So from the survey leak, I believe the new protagonist is the Pathfinder.
Yeah.
And you're basically trying to find a new home for humanity. So you can go from your ship, the Tempest, to the ground, you know, find new settlements.
Cruise around in the Mako.
Cruise around. The Mako's back. We've seen the Mako in action. I think they showed on N7 Day.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't that already sound really cool as an idea for a setting, trying to find a new home for humanity? Mm-hmm. Doesn't that sound amazing?
Yeah.
Like, just that on its own.
What do you think the likelihood is of a alien protagonist?
I mean, I think that would be
interesting. I'd love to play as an Asari.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or even a Krogan. Could you imagine if it was finding a new home for humanity and you're playing as an Asari. Maybe
that's
it doesn't
true.
Make sense.
Yeah.
But, like, it would be super cool.
I really miss
an alien for hire. Yeah. I'm going to find the new homeworld.
Miss Morden. He was just...
Oh.
No spoilers, but...
You what?
Something happens.
Morden Solis.
Unless you go renegade the whole thing, and then the thing doesn't happen.
No way.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
He is the very model of a scientist Solarian. Mm.
The thing doesn't happen if you go renegade.
The thing doesn't happen if you're not... Oh. Yeah.
Kind of lie to him.
No, it's set in, according to that leak, it's set in the Andromeda Galaxy, I think is what the leak said.
Mm-hmm. What does that mean?
That means that it's set in the Andromeda Galaxy, Rob.
Oh.
It's right there, Rob.
Andromeda Galaxy?
No, the leak mentions that you're in some sort of settlement in the Andromeda Galaxy, and you're doing that from there. What?
Sorry, nothing. No, just how many times you said
Andromeda. Don't make me come over there. I'll come over there.
But they also, right. also mentioned they had a kind of gameplay concept that was similar to the war table from Dragon Age Inquisition. So you're mm-hmm. sending agents out to, you know, clear the galaxy for the benefit of humanity.
Are you a bit worried about all that scanning of the planet stuff?
No, I love that.
I really love that.
That was
as well.
Actually kind of satisfying.
Although BioWare have outright said that we know players hated that, so it's gone.
Oh.
Oh well.
But we didn't.
Well, Mass Effect, we can speculate a lot. Surveys can tell us maybe something, but
ask a question.
Really, we're going to just see what Rob has to ask right now.
What do you think is the bigger game? Star Wars Battlefront or Mass Effect? What do you think is EA's biggest showpiece today?
If it's Mass Effect, well, because if it's Mass Effect, it would probably be a trailer, if anything. Yeah. But Battlefront's going to be gameplay.
Mass
going
Effect
on.
Won't be out before the end of the year. If right. You know what I mean? Like, they're not going to put two sci-fi, you know, big space IPs out in the same. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm.
Also, I did a show floor creep, and there's some really great Battlefront statues sitting in EA's booth. It looks really great.
Awesome. Mm.
Definitely going to be a big emphasis on Battlefront at EA's press conference today. Maybe some Mass Effect, we're hoping, but one game that we've been hoping for years to see come to fruition and now is finally happening, Mirror's Edge Catalyst, mm-hmm, I believe. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mirror's Edge Catalyst, going to see that game in action. What do you guys think?
Heck yeah. It looks like they're doing, I saw the writer of the first one, Rihanna Pratchett, was talking on Twitter about how they're slashing and burning the story. Like, it's sort of a reboot. It's not a prequel, it's like a sort of...
It's a weird reboot thing. There's going to be a comic book that ties into Faith's actual origins, and then this Catalyst.
Mm-hmm. I mean, no disrespect to the original's writers, but I didn't think the story was very good in the first game, to be honest. I thought it was quite forgettable and a bit lame.
I do remember Rihanna coming in and saying that the writers were basically brought in to try and fix that at the last moment.
And you
like,
can,
it
you
wasn't,
can sense
it wasn't
that.
Kind of developed side by side.
They did totally save it, though, because the game ends with a first-person hug.
Yeah.
Which is just all too rare in video gaming these days. I think we can all agree.
Have you ever seen Peep Show?
Whoa.
Rob?
No.
This is a British
moved on from the Mass Effect sex talk.
Sitcom.
It's a British comedy. It's nothing weird.
Okay.
It's a British comedy.
Yeah, British comedies are never weird.
But it's like first-person British comedy where they hug and kiss.
Oh, all
right. Not like that. That's a long story.
Maybe let's not call that one up on the B-roll production
it
staff.
Is really good.
But Mirror's Edge is going to be there. Yeah. And so we're going to mm-hmm. see that in its new incarnation with all of its pristine white walls and shiny red elements for you to parkour on. Mm. We're also going to see an EA franchise, perhaps the most iterated upon EA franchise outside of the EA Sports realm, Need for Speed.
Mm. I've got the need.
Yep.
Don't say it.
I've got the slight interest for
why?
Motor
cars. Why just a slight interest, Rob?
I just think, like, where can you take cars these days? I mean, as in, like, where can you take racing games these
days?
And
get Henry Ford III on stage.
Yeah, that's the best you can do, really. I feel like this franchise is a bit tired, and I suppose also, like, I'm romantic for Burnout Paradise. I really miss playing an open world racing game like that, and...
What if it was a Need for Speed open world racing game?
It's a reboot.
I'd be hot for it.
It's a reboot, so you can.
Oh, really?
So maybe you like.
Also, your Rivals came out. Rivals was the launch title for 360? No, for Xbox One and PS4. This one had a year. Like, you know, we had a year where we didn't have a Need for Speed, which I think was the first. I know this because I actually looked it up. The first time in like 12 years that we didn't have a Need for Speed game.
Yeah.
If it wasn't that, it was almost exactly that. Because, the yearly iteration for that franchise is huge. And though they've done reboots, you know, they've had Underground and all sort of little diversions, and Rivals was a variation of that. It'd be nice to see what they've got with an extra year under their belt.
So I think the thing that they've been saying is that there's going to be an immersive narrative.
Oh, boy.
Which I'm interested to see how they do in a car game, because they've touched on it before. Mm. But then you have games like The Crew. Remember that one?
Mm, yeah,
where they tried to have a story thing and it didn't really work out.
Well, the last wasn't there a Need for Speed where you get out of the car and you like run along, jumping on buildings, and then like that's sort of the like action hero kind of Need for Speed.
I don't remember ever jumping on a building in a Need for Speed game. Were you jumping on a building in the car?
I think it was
out
like
of the
a
car.
QT
no, you
thing,
got
right?
out of the car. Yeah, it was
that
a QTE.
That would be cool if you had like. What are they called when you pump your car and they bounce?
Hydraulics.
Hydraulics, and your car can just like What if that's it? You mean
Pimp My Ride, the game?
Yes.
Which does exist, I think.
Oh, yeah. That's a classic.
Yeah.
All right, Need for Speed. And then there's another sort of, speaking of Burnout Paradise, last year at EA's press conference, we saw a game from Criterion, developers of Burnout Paradise, it was like some kind of extreme sports melange. There was wingsuiting and ATVs and maybe some other extreme stuff that I can't really remember.
Is the deal that it's all in first person, right? Is that what was going on?
Not that I feel like I remember, because it was also one of these, EA press conference last year was a very much like, here are some developers talking about their game. Here is the game shown on the developer screen. Here's like a few seconds of prototype footage.
Very
so,
teasy.
Yeah, it was
he
really
Casey Hudson's
heavy.
Lovely face.
Yeah, I am really hoping that their press conference this year goes away from that teasy stuff.
Yeah.
And the teasies become the substantial meaties.
Yep. Mm. Put your money where your mouth is,
that's a technical
EA.
Term. We did see another EA game at the Microsoft press conference, Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare.
You know what?
Two.
I'm going to defend Garden Warfare because people never
ever... You and me both, Lucy. I'm right there with you.
Never talk about the game. And you know what? That game was really fun.
It looks
like
really fun.
It was just real... Like, that's the only thing I can say about it. It was really fun, and it had really nice little customization stuff, unlockables, big, fun maps that were really colorful, great, you know, classes, loadouts. It was just it was a good game.
It was. I totally agree.
Yeah, I'm really interested in these new character designs. The corn and the skanky flower.
The wizard
and
flower
the
sorceress.
The tangerine was my favorite.
I don't know. She was making a skanky face.
Well, you know, she's making it at zombies. I don't know.
The tangerine. Here it is.
The, like,
you
Matrix.
Whoop.
Oh, yeah, this.
Oh, nice.
No.
This
no.
thing?
Right, well,
yeah.
Slow-mo.
He's got the leaf goatee. Oh, I didn't notice that before.
Okay,
the leaf goatee is
cool.
Awesome.
The corn in the background with the kernels.
The thing about Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare that I think is something people are enjoying about Splatoon currently is just that, like, you can have these kind of competitive games that involve shooting and that are kind of intense and team versus team, but they don't have to be gritty. They don't have to be a Call of Duty or Battlefield. Mm. They can be saturated with color and they can be like whimsical and kind of fun.
Yeah.
As the mechanics are strong and it's well built, it's can be a really fun experience. So maybe we'll see a little bit more of that. I gotta imagine they'll show something more than just that same trailer they showed during the Microsoft press conference. Then we'll have a block of sports.
Boring.
Sports block.
Sports, huh?
Going to see some FIFA, some Madden, probably some Rory McIlroy golf.
NHL?
Maybe.
Did they do NHL?
NHL?
Oh, yeah, Rory McIlroy. The pre-order bonus, I think, this year is a golf umbrella.
What?
You get a golf umbrella?
I think you can get a golf
Those
umbrella.
Those things are intense.
Whoa.
It's like the giant one that's got the flaps,
yep.
and like you could actually bludgeon someone with it, believably.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. There's
that's
also
my
like
kind of bonus.
That's our sports knowledge.
I think there's also going to be a UFC game, right? Doesn't EA?
EA does UFC.
EA
too.
And then there's the NBA as well.
So of sports. Course,
yeah.
Which is very
sports.
Topical, given
sports
the Golden
ball.
State Warriors.
Sports ball.
One game
sports.
Away
sports.
From
sports.
The championship.
But
sports.
FIFA. I think FIFA's, you know, props them for finally including female teams.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's great timing as well, because it's the
Women's
World Cup.
Yeah.
Up in Canada. Mm. Sports block, it's happening. You know what's not happening? Titanfall 2.
Titanfall 2.
Battlefield, they're not going to have Battlefield, is that correct?
Battlefield is typically a GDC announcement joint, isn't it? They typically show them around GDC.
I mean, I think DICE have got their hands full.
That's true. With Battlefront,
right.
you don't want to confuse the branding with Battlefield,
Battlefront.
Battlecry, Battleborn.
So those things are probably in the works, but probably not going to show up at the press conference, which is starting in about 12 minutes from now. Thank you guys, by the way, for joining us for our EA pre-show show that we're doing. Let's talk about EA Access for a minute, because this is something that they talked about during the Microsoft press conference.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like the sexiest of topics to discuss in front of a room full of people who want to cheer your stuff on and the flashing lights and all that. But
a little bit of a boner killer, actually.
Yeah. Like, so how do you handle that kind of thing? Because ostensibly it's like, subscribe to this, you get access to these cool games. Is it just an inherently not cool program, or is it just the kind of thing you don't really try to razzle-dazzle?
I don't think it's an inherently not cool program. I think maybe EA just hasn't, like PlayStation with PlayStation Now, hasn't really found their footing with what they want that service to really be. I like that they're putting more games on it. I think this week only, you can play like 20 games for free, 10 games or something for free.
Yeah, they announced that for Xbox Live Gold, at least, members will be able to play all 12, is that right?
Yep.
In the vault. It's unlocked. Yeah. And they also announced that Dragon Age Inquisition and Titanfall will be coming to that vault later this year.
Yep.
I think they've got the basics down right. I think the idea of $5 a month for this collection of games is good. I think the discount is a good idea. I think the chance to play games early is a really good idea.
Yeah.
I think the only thing missing right now is there's not enough games in the vault. Right. It's not really a vault at the moment. It's more a...
You got Peggle 2. You don't need any more games. Okay.
Okay. Whatever you say.
Yeah. $5 a month to play Peggle 2, though. That 4 months later, you own Peggle 2, or you don't.
We get it in PS Plus when it inevitably goes on
when
there.
It maybe gets free or on sale.
I mean, if you're the kind of person who doesn't have the budget to spend, you know, $60 five times a month on games, I think that provided there are more games on EA Access, then I think it could become a very good service.
Mm-hmm.
You pay $5, you can play Inquisition, figure out if you like it, buy it if you want to keep it forever. But they're not quite there yet.
Yeah, but they will certainly be banging the drum. You got to imagine there's going to be some kind of access plan revolving around Battlefront, especially.
Yeah.
Presumably that game. I feel like the kind of standard and something that DICE has also a history of doing is multiplayer betas.
Mm-hmm.
There's probably going to be some kind of beta. Wouldn't be surprised if that was.
No, that's good.
Announced during EA. And then also wouldn't be surprised if access people get a bonus week of it or something like that. I think But you have to draw the line there. Like, at what point does that feel like you're giving people an opportunity versus like withholding and cheating people out of some opportunity?
You think it might backlash?
I mean, you have to draw the line somewhere, right? So where do they draw it? That's probably one of the challenges they tackle when trying to give the access.
Yeah.
All right. Some other maybe EA names. Anything? Sim gonna come across here?
I so doubt it. They've been just releasing little expansion packs and talking about it. I think that's done.
I mean, the Sims 4 got such... Being a Sims fan has been really difficult for the last few years. I mean,
it's been a struggle for you, has it?
You had the Sim City just absolute crisis.
Mm-hmm.
And then Sims 4, which basically released as the basest of base games with a bunch of, jobs that you'd had in The Sims 1, like career paths just completely taken out.
No toddlers, no pools.
No toddlers, no pools. And then to be added back in.
When you put those back to back, it sounds like
DLC.
A good thing.
And then obviously the closure of Maxis.
Yeah.
So you think they should stop making Sims games, take a lot of time building something really good, and then announce, right?
They should just remake The Sims 2.
Remake The Sims 2.
It's the best one.
Sims 2
HD.
I
agree. I think Sims 2 was the better game.
Wow. Heard it first.
Team Sims 2.
But yeah, I really doubt The Sims will be there. And that saddens me because, it's top of the line simulation.
They usually wait for Gamescom to talk about The Sims, though, don't they? Because it's huge in Germany, right? Or am I just making that up?
No, you're not making it up.
Oh, cool.
PC games in general are just huge in Germany. And The Sims especially.
But I think this year, certainly from Microsoft's perspective, announcing that Crackdown, Scalebound, and Phantom Dust were not going to be talked about till Gamescom, that's kind of, they're doing it for their own schedule, but it also sort of is a signal to me a little bit of the continuing raising profile of Gamescom. I mean, that show has been huge for years, but in terms of, exclusive announcements in terms of publishers coming there really big, I think that's been growing significantly year after year.
Well, because I'm a bit of a loser, I've been thinking a lot
about this.
a lot then.
Harsh.
Anyway.
Come on.
The reason why I think Microsoft are pushing really hard on Gamescom is because Sony are pulling away from Gamescom. Sony are going to skip Gamescom this year. They're going to have their... they're going to go to that Paris event.
The PlayStation Experience?
The Paris Game Show?
Paris Game Show, right. Yeah.
There's a Paris Game Show.
So I imagine Microsoft looked at that and said, right, we've got a great opportunity at Gamescom to show off our games because Sony's not going to be there, which is why I think they're saving some of their big AAA titles for Gamescom.
Well, if Sony's not there, I guess we can go. No, it's not like that. But yeah, that's totally right. And also, PlayStation have the PlayStation Experience. Like, they don't need to piggyback off the stage of another event because they have their own thing now. And it showed last year that it really worked.
It was very impressive. That opening keynote was like an hour and a half of just bam, 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 bam. Like it was
Uncharted 4.
People just came and focused on their games. Like I can't imagine Sony won't in the future start using that as their big keynote.
Yeah.
Rather than E3.
Wow. Yeah, it might be in a few years.
E3 might become one of those I can definitely see it as PlayStation experience. Here are our announcements. Here's everything coming. And here's what we have playable. And then E3 being like the here's more. I can absolutely see that happening.
It's very already happened a little bit. The 2 weeks before E3 even, there were a lot of announcements, a lot of trailers come out. And then we see more at E3. Mm-hmm. You know, it's sort of becoming the thing that people tease for as opposed to the place where they make that big splash, that big announcement.
Yeah.
However, let's talk about the likelihood that EA is going to announce any kind of new IP, any kind of surprises. I mean, you got to have it. You can't just have a lineup of stuff that everyone knows is coming. You got to have something, right?
There's got to be. I'm guessing that they are going to talk about, didn't they talk about last year, they made a partnership with Starbreeze or something? There was an indie studio that they partnered with.
Oh, really?
I can see I can see EA getting into the super indie partnership game. Ubisoft does it. Sony and Microsoft do it. Like, I would like to see that from them. I'd like to see them supporting smaller games.
I think that would complete their slate because they're going for every single genre, and I think that's the one thing that's missing. So I wouldn't
that
be surprised
would be
if I saw that.
Also, I think the question is, what is BioWare Austin working on now Shadow Realms got cancelled? Because we know that BioWare are working on Mass Effect. We know they have a secret project. And Shadow Realms was a 4v1 asynchronous multiplayer game that was going to come out. It got announced at Gamescom to not much of a fanfare.
I feel like people had the trouble conceiving of what that was. What was it going to be?
It was 4v1, but at the same time, it had the single player with the typical BioWare character progression, relationships, all that kind of stuff. And I just don't think people got it. They said they were going to have an alpha. And that just didn't happen. And then the game just sort of quietly...
just wind it down.
Which is a shame, because I actually played it, and I had a lot of fun with it. But what is that team working on now? I put that question to you. To panel and Peter Moore.
That's not the only game that we saw last year that they pulled out. They also canceled Dawngate, their MOBA.
To be fair, though, Infinite Crisis just got... It seems like big AAA publishers trying to get into the MOBA game, they're kind of either not doing it right, or maybe they're expecting big gains just straight away
really
and it's just not
quickly.
Happening.
Yeah.
Also, a game like that, like if you look at League, a game that's continuously evolving, maybe they just didn't. I don't know. I don't want to speculate, but it just seems like they're just trying to get in on that game. And
yeah,
it just
they are. But a lot of publishers know you're a bit too late to the party, to be honest. There's League, there's Dota. You can't, it's going to be very expensive to muscle your way in on that, to be honest. And, so they're not trying.
They've already got a ton of that mind share, yeah.
Yeah, it's also very difficult to carve your own game in that genre because the two big players are so well defined and you're never going to escape the comparison.
And the comparisons are excellent, right?
I mean, completely top level. So. Yeah. Don't make MOBAs.
Well, instead of MOBAs this year, we have those team action battle with MOBA-esque elements
that
around
all look
them.
Really similar.
A team-based arena shooter is the new
that's
non-dirty
the term
word for
we're
MOBA.
Looking for.
Team-based arena shooter because they don't want to say MOBA. MOBA's a dirty word. Don't say MOBA.
Yeah, it also you say MOBA, people think of League and Dota.
Yeah.
All right, we are just about 2 minutes away from the start of EA's press conference. So at any time we could be cutting over there. We're looking at a feed of the darkened room now. Everyone is basking in the glow of the green
EA logo.
They're all sitting down to enjoy nothing. Is there anything on those tables?
So last year they had a big box of donuts.
A big box of
donuts? They did.
Oh, man.
So just saying, kind of jealous that we're
here. And they
didn't
announce a new Simpsons game, you're saying?
Is anyone there right now? Can anyone bring us back to EA donuts?
I don't know.
I will try.
Donuts are still unconfirmed. That's a
donuts
non-confirmed rumor at the EA press conference.
Breaking report, donuts at press conference.
I feel like I'm really flying the BioWare flag here, but we haven't talked about Dragon Age.
Oh, wow.
Because we have more DLC to come.
They said it was narrative DLC, right?
And in the pre-show that we did in the lobby, I mixed up the Hero of Ferelden with the Inquisitor, and I'm so sorry for that. So apparently this next piece of story DLC is not going to have the Grey Warden from the first game in.
Oh.
But that's all we
but
know.
But who's it going to have? Probably some new companions, maybe? What do you want from a Inquisition DLC.
Well, no spoilers, but Inquisition ended on one hell of a cliffhanger, so I kind of want to see that addressed at some point. Also, having the first piece of DLC hit straight after Witcher, at least on PlayStation, was unfortunate because I still haven't played it yet. Maybe when I get back from E3.
I think the Witcher has had an effect, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Because that game...
A Mass Effect.
Ah!
Oh, God.
Sorry.
Be sure to stay tuned for the post show where we will rehearse all of our EA-related puns.
So I hope we will see, or at least a hint of, the next piece of Dragon Age DLC. Nope.
What are you guys most looking forward to today?
Mass Effect.
Wow.
Unanimity,
Mass Effect. Yeah. I can't wait to see it. I think they're going to show actual gameplay of the next Mass Effect.
Really? Do you think it will be the same core kind of gameplay, the same like third-person shooter dealio?
I really hope so. I mean, I really hope so, because I love their blend of like RTS half meets sort of action.
We're getting a countdown right now, 20 seconds. Anything you want to say.
Oh, my God.
Anything. Come on, Alexa, Lucy, Rob, anything else? No? Stay tuned after the EA press conference for our EA Wrap post show, where we will talk about all the fantastic new IPs they announce, all the awesome Mass Effect footage we see, and all the other things we really hope come true.
An old cowboy went riding out one dark and windy day. Up on a ridge he rested as he went along his way. When all at once a mighty herd of the night cows he saw plowing through the ragged sky.
Mass Effect Andromeda from our storytellers at BioWare. Welcome everyone to our show here at the Shrine Expo Hall in Los Angeles. Thanks to those of you watching on our live stream, and thanks to our audience here with us today. We're joined by players from our community, journalists from around the world, and our colleagues and partners from our great industry. This year, we're also excited to be hosting more than 300 high school and university students from across Greater Los Angeles. Welcome. I hope we can inspire and entertain you with what you see here today. This is going to be an action-packed show, chock full of new games you'll be able to play either this year or next. Play. Let's talk about that for just a moment. It's a simple idea. We think the world is a better place when we all make time to play. For us at EA, our passion for play is what inspires us to get up in the morning. It's what focuses us. We live to play, and it drives us to do our very best to create the next amazing experience. To immerse you in new worlds. To imagine new characters that will draw on your emotions. To transport you into adventures that capture your imagination. Play is our shared passion. It's what connects us with all of you. So here we go. We've got more than a dozen new experiences to share, and here's a little taste. Over the next few minutes, you'll see three original IPs, including one that I promise is unlike anything you're expecting. Later, we have a special guest, a living legend from the world of sport. And how about Mirror's Edge? Faith is back, and we have the exclusive first look. And of course, Star Wars. It's the year... It's the year of Star Wars here at EA with games for console, PC, and mobile. We have news on each of them today, including, of course, our grand finale, Star Wars Battlefront. I'll leave you with a couple of final thoughts. Putting players first continues to be our focus at Electronic Arts. It's a commitment that inspires everything that you're going to see here today. More games to play brought to life by our talented teams pioneering new ideas with cutting-edge new technology. More ways to play driven by what we learn each day through our conversations with you. Thank you. You make us better. No, thank you. Let's get into the action. As someone who loves cars, I can tell you this next game is stunning. But enough from me, let's check out the return of Need for Speed.
Icons can drive you, push you to the edge, and around here, they will inspire you. For some, style is all that matters. Others build, searching for perfection. The fearless always push the limit or crave the thrill of the chase. Some only ride with their crew, but all do it for the reputation. How you drive, it's up to you. Remember you. You need to know that I'm right. Tonight we're gonna set the streets on fire.
All I need is a gas and a lighter. That is the new Need for Speed, inspired by some of the most beloved games in the series, from the customization of Underground to the world of Carbon. From the narrative style of Most Wanted to the innovation and visuals of Rivals. We are bringing 20 years of history together for the definitive Need for Speed experience. So, welcome to Ventura Bay, home to five real-world icons who are the heroes of today's car culture. Build reputation and earn their respect on your journey to become the ultimate icon. From dusk to dawn, discover a rich open-world environment that's roughly twice the size of Rivals and drive the sweeping hillside roads to the police-infested urban districts with tight city corners. You can explore it, race it, and own it. The visual leap forward, thanks to Frostbite's physical-based rendering, will make you question whether it's real or in-game, from the realistic world to the iconic cars. But how do you make it your own? By delivering the richest customization ever seen in a Need for Speed game. Your ride is built with the hottest authentic aftermarket brands, performance tuning, and personalized car handling. This is the customization our fans have been asking for. And when you're behind the wheel, we're bringing you a new kind of narrative that will pull you through your experience. Built around our icons are five action-packed overlapping stories where every choice, every second, every minute propels your progression through our five ways to play. First, we have speed, fully committed, focused on top speed and maximum adrenaline. Next is style, sliding, jumping, dancing your car across the fully open world in a cloud of smoke. Build, the never-ending search for your perfection in how your car looks, sounds, and drives. Crew, blasting through the streets with your friends, inches away from wiping each other out. And finally, outlaw, the thrill of the chase and the chaos that that brings. All combined to create that perfect Need for Speed moment, driving insanely fast, sliding through a corner in your customized ride alongside your friends while being chased by cops. You specialize or you switch between them to become the ultimate icon. And when you do, you'll earn the respect and the recognition you deserve. Coming November 3rd, this is the new Need for Speed.
Hey, yo. I saw Nakai-san work a build once. It took him 4 hours just to fit one wide body flare. Folks came and left. An unartistic mind grows bored with perfection. But the Nakai-san, every panel was a single brushstroke. It was a masterpiece.
Precisely why I'm worried he'll never come.
Don't worry, he'll come.
Yo, guys, some big names in town. Let's get out there and get noticed.
Manu just asked to meet up.
Ultimate Shred, man, seriously. This is gonna be off the hook.
Made it! Awesome! Get in here.
The whole game! So what are we waiting for? Consider yourself noticed. We'll be in touch.
Star Wars: The Old Republic offers RPG gamers the chance to step into the center of their own Star Wars saga. So if you love Star Wars and want a deep experience, then start playing now and get ready, because something new is on the way. Our fans have told us exactly what they want in the future. More story, BioWare-style story, with a player-driven arc where choices matter. And we've been listening. Today, I'm proud to announce that we are taking Star Wars: The Old Republic back to the roots of BioWare-style storytelling with the release of our new expansion, Knights of the Fallen Empire. This is your story, your way, and it's coming October 27, 2015. Knights of the Fallen Empire puts you in the center of the battle against a dangerous new enemy faction. You will choose your path. You will join or betray companions old and new, and you will make choices that will shape the fate of the entire galaxy, as well as your own. The expansion will deliver on the hallmarks of what makes a great BioWare game: new worlds to explore, new companions to recruit, and a dynamic story that players will be able to shape based on the choices they make. And in appreciation of our players' support over the years, Knights of the Fallen Empire will be free to all of our subscribers. I'll leave you with a first look at the story of Knights of the Fallen Empire. Thank you, and may the Force be with you.
A man can have anything if he is willing to sacrifice.
That's a massive new expansion from BioWare, and the first Star Wars game we will show you today. Star Wars Battlefront comes a little later, but there's a lot more to get to first. Across EA Studios, we are all creators. It's a role we take very seriously, to imagine, build, and deliver the experiences that will inspire and amaze all of you as players. For us, players first take on a very special meaning. It all starts with gameplay. Whether it's a blockbuster franchise or something entirely fresh and new, it all comes back to how well it actually plays. But it's not just up to us. We need your input as well. We're listening to you, your feedback, every day. We're hosting more community members in our studios, bringing you in to meet with our development teams. This year, we'll hold more betas and playtests that get you into the games before launch. We want your feedback to help shape the experiences that we create. The direct conversation we have with you is where we can come together as players and game makers. The shared passion we have for play drives creativity in all our games, including the next two original IPs we're about to show you. The first one is unlike anything else you'll see here today. A year ago, I went to see this group called Coldwood in northern Sweden. The moment I saw the game they're making, I knew we had to bring it to all of you. It's an experience that is emotional and deeply creative, centered on a tiny character with a huge heart. This is Unravel.
Hello, everyone. My name is Martin Salin, and that is Jarni. And I'm going to tell you all about that in a moment. But let me first just say that it feels so great to be here on this stage. I'm just so happy to finally be here and get to show you all this game that we made, this little thing called Unravel. I'm the creative director at Coldwood. We're a little studio made up of 14 people from Umeå in northern Sweden. And I think that games are really powerful things. They have the ability to grab you and move you in a way that few other art forms can. And that gives us as game makers a certain responsibility, I think. We should try to do more than to just entertain. And Unravel was created in that spirit. It was born out of the need to make something more personal, something with a heart. It's a puzzle platformer where you play as a little character made of yarn, which unravels as you move. And the yarn, it represents love and the bonds that we make. And it unravels because that's what happens when we're separated from what we love. In this game, you are the red thread that runs through someone's life, trying to tie all their missing pieces back together. Now, I made most of this design while I was on a camping trip with my family, way out in the countryside. I was so full of ideas, but I didn't have a lot of tools to work with out there, so I figured I could just kind of like act out the gameplay. And that's how Yarny came to be. And I actually brought him with me. Hi! I created this little doll with some old metal wire that I found and some yarn that I managed to borrow, and then I just, like, I wandered around in the woods. I was putting yarn in different situations and snapping pictures and figuring out fun ways that you could use your yarn. And I wanted the whole game to feel just like that, too. Like it's an exploration. It's a quest where you have to be clever and creative to find the proper path. And the game is centered on Yarny. This little character was on a big journey and accomplishing big things despite being so small. The gameplay is all physics-based. You have to find the way forward and overcome all these obstacles that you'll come across. And those problems can have simple solutions, like using your yarn to swing across a gap, or sometimes things might get more complex. So when you look back at that tangled and winding weave of yarn left behind you, you have to stop and wonder how you ever got there. It's kind of like life. I mean, I certainly didn't see myself standing here today back when I was playing with Yarny out in the woods 2 summers ago, but here I am, and I am really, really glad that I finally get to share this game with you all. Unravel... Thank you. Unravel means a lot to us at Coldwood. We put our hearts into this, and we hope that when you play it, you will feel that. So, thank you, and enjoy.
You can't take zombies anywhere. Go big. Go crazy. Have fun. This is Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare 2. When we released Garden Warfare in 2014, it quickly became a runaway hit. From people like me who play the game with their kids, to the most competitive of gamers, over 6 million players fell in love with this shooter that doesn't take itself too seriously. Now, in Garden Warfare 2, Dr. Zomboss, the evil genius leader of the zombies, has finally discovered a way to turn the tide of battle and take suburbia from the plants. We put you in an all-new world where, for the first time in franchise history, the plants are on the attack. Now, joining you in this new world are six crazy new character classes from the past, the present, and the future, each armed with outrageous weapons and abilities that will introduce a new strategic layer of depth to your battles. Now, here to give you your very first look with a live gameplay demo, producer Kyle Duncan, creative director Justin Wiebe, and members of the Garden Warfare 2 development team. Guys?
Hello, and welcome to ZTech Industries. Today we're getting our first look at a brand new map, Zomboss Factory, built by Dr. Zomboss as part of his ongoing war effort to create Zomburbia. Today is not going to be an ordinary day. To defend the factory. We're going to live gameplay of our new four-player zombie co-op mode, Graveyard Ops. Our first new class is the Imp. Is the smallest, fastest, and possibly craziest zombie in the game. Here is Super Brains, the zombie's all-new melee class. This is Captain Deadbeard, the zombie's first sniper class. Looks like the Imp is going to need something just a little bit bigger.
Hey,
Awesome teamwork, everyone. It's time to evacuate. Eject! Eject! Great job, zombies.
Awesome job, guys. How fun does that look? So Graveyard Ops, our zombie co-op mode we just saw, was our number one most fan-requested feature. Now, a close second was the ability to play the game single-player. Now, in Garden Warfare 2, you can play multiplayer with or against your friends. And for the very first time, we are introducing a unique solo play experience, where you can play every single game mode by yourself against AI, or with the help of a friend via local split screen. This, combined with other surprises, will offer a new twist in how you experience this universe. Now, your feedback has played a major role in the development of Garden Warfare 2. So as a thank you, we're giving all players of the original Garden Warfare the ability to transfer almost all of their unlocked characters directly into Garden Warfare 2 right from launch. We think this is an awesome way to kickstart this all-new adventure with your favorite plants and zombies. Now, Garden Warfare 2 will launch in spring 2016, but this is just the beginning. We feel that if you invest your time in our game, that we should invest in you with free content updates. We will continue to deliver free content updates long after launch to ensure that Zomburbia stays action-packed. Now, we're working really, really hard to make sure that the world of Garden Warfare is crazy, hilarious, and most of all, fun to play. We thank you for all the input you've given us, and we cannot wait for you to get your hands on this all-new Plants vs. Zombies game. So thank you, and I'll see you in Zomburbia.
Gentlemen, the way we're playing out there, that isn't gonna cut it. Not in this league. Not in any league. All that matters is what we do with these next 20 minutes. So ask yourself, what makes a team great? Is it talent? Or is it teamwork? Is it doing whatever it takes to win? Not for yourself, but for the man next to you.
Yeah. Come on, boys.
That's what separates us from them. Winners from losers. It's been a long, hard season, but here we are. One more shot. Play the next 20 minutes for each other and leave the ice as champions.
Team is at the heart of hockey, and this year it's at the heart of NHL 16. And nowhere is that more true than in our all-new EA Sports Hockey League for the ultimate in team competition. This year we spent more time listening and working with fans than ever before. And that feedback is helping us create innovation throughout NHL 16. Today I'd like to talk about great things happening across EA Sports, so let's keep going with that theme of innovation. On July the 14th, Rory McIlroy PGA Tour launches as the first EA Sports game built using our Frostbite engine, opening up the golf experience. With the ability to stream full courses, players will truly be able to play the ball as it lies, no matter where it lands. Plus, no load times between holes shaves up to 15 minutes off your round. We've got stunning real-world courses and epic fantasy experiences. I mean, look at that. Very cool. This is golf without limits. Now, EA Sports Ultimate Team is where you build, manage, and play with your personal dream team. It connects our games to the heartbeat of sport throughout the season and beyond. We're constantly feeding Ultimate Teams with new content, so every time you jump in, it feels fresh. In fact, this year we delivered double the new content to Ultimate Teams than last season. Ultimate Teams are the most popular way to play across all of EA Sports, and we're committed to ensuring a safe and secure play environment. So no matter your sport, Ultimate Team will be fun and fair for everyone. And we want you to get the most out of your game. So this year, we're going to make you a better player. If you're new to EA Sports, we want to get you in the game. If you're a veteran player, we want to take your skills to the next level. New modes in FIFA and NHL give you contextual feedback on how to make better crosses or how to snipe that perfect wrist shot. And here, in Madden NFL, we've got training right in the game. There's even on-screen help to get you the skills and game knowledge to get right in. So, let's move on to our next big game. Here is NBA Live executive producer, Sean O'Brien.
Thank you, sir. Basketball is a game of self-expression. NBA superstars constantly amaze me with their flair, both on and off the court. Now check out that outfit. And you know what? NBA Live 16 is rooted in self-expression. This comes to life in both how you look and how you play, so that your entire in-game journey is all about you. And it's made possible through a feature set requested by basketball video game players because we make it a priority to listen to you. And what you see today is a direct result of that. It starts with self-expression off the court, with a brand new app that features our exclusive GameFace HD scanning tech. And I want to show you just how easy it is to use and how good you're going to look in game. Now we've got our NBA Live community manager, the Hoop God, here to help you. Come on up here, Hoop God. Where are you? There you are. How are you?
What's up? How are you doing, man?
All right.
I see LA's been good to you.
Oh, really?
Light work.
All right. All right, Hoop God. So let's show them how to do this. Here you go. Here's the app. I'll hold your hat for you. Pause right there. So you can see he's trying to fill his face in this circle right there. Pressing the camera gut. That's right. Slowly to the right. Back to the middle. And now to the left. And that's it. So what's happening right now, the app is actually generating a scan. It takes about 5 seconds. And it's going to generate a preview for us. Oh, it's ready. Here we go. Let's take a look.
Damn, that looks just like me.
There we go.
Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. You're going to fix the ball spot, though, right?
Oh, yeah, we'll take care of that in-game. Don't worry about it. We got you. NBA Live 16 hits the streets September 29th, and this app will be available before the game launches.
So, get ready to get yourself fresh, people just like me, the Hoop God.
All right, Hoop God, thanks for your help.
All right, man.
Get out of here. So in just a few minutes, the HD scan brings you to life in the game just like the NBA stars. Hoop God scanned himself last week so we can all see what he looks like in-game. Pretty hot. If you've ever wanted to be in a video game, trust me, GameFace HD is the easiest and best way to get it done. And you'll only find it in NBA Live. Now, once you're in game, you'll be able to express yourself any way you choose. As you progress, you'll use global XP earned from across the entire game to up your swag and improve your skill set. Now let's take a look at self-expression on the court. We are laser focused on giving you unparalleled control and best-in-class animation fidelity. First, we spent 2 years building a physics-based player movement system called Live Motion. Now, using an innovative approach to motion capture, we've literally created thousands of new animations. And paired with runtime physics, this results in contextual, free-flowing movement, like what you'd expect to see on the basketball court. Now, this dynamic nature of Live Motion keeps you in control of your player's movement. You won't feel like you're stuck in a scripted animation. This will truly free your game. Second, completely rebuilt passing and catching systems will allow you to distribute the ball exactly when and where you want with touch passing and dribble handoffs. This gives you never seen before options to move the ball around the perimeter. Next, let's take a look at the pick and roll. It's the bread and butter of today's NBA. And in these situations, NBA Live 16 gives you the type of control you've been asking for. Screen and rescreen. Choose whether the screener rolls, pops, or slips. Now you can choose how you defend it by showing, trapping the ball, or even switching. Finally, our players have also told us that they want more control when shooting the basketball. We've created a new shot system that gives you full control to release the ball when you want. So the longer you actually hold the button press, the later you'll release, giving you complete control of your shot in situations all over the court. We've never had this level of gameplay control before. So for those of you at E3, please come by and check it out. You really have to feel it to know just how much these new controls change the game. And later this summer, we're gonna be revealing a new game mode. And let's just say we're committed to delivering a reliable and stable place to play basketball online with your friends. It's time to rise together. Now let's take a look at our trailer featuring footage captured entirely from in-game. Thank you.
West up. Turn the volume up and bang it out. This one is for the trunk. Wake up the neighborhood when it dump. Rather it's ride bass and easy rock and pump. Like my old Reeboks. If you pop, I pump. Meaning I rock. Nothing and no one can stop me. Stop what I do. Stop the stuff. Why not? I'm young. Probably seem over-sogenic. Pocket pun word to Migos. I move words by the kilo. Heard. I used to move birds with my amigos.
Turn it up. Turn the volume up and bang it out the truck now. Turn the volume up and bang it out the truck now.
I'm about to turn it.
That's what I'm talking about. There you go. Let's run this back.
Good afternoon. Let's talk about mobile. It's the single biggest gaming platform in the world. The sheer appetite for mobile games is staggering. Last year, we downloaded our games more than 750 million times across our consumers. That's 2 million times a day in more than 235 countries and territories. Most impressive, this year, players have already logged more than 400,000 years of gameplay. And we're always making our games more exciting. With Need for Speed No Limits, we're pushing smartphones and tablets further than ever. We're also inspired by new devices. FIFA 15 Ultimate Team mobile players are obsessed with building squads, so we made it easy for them to manage their auctions right from their Apple Watch. We're delivering the amazing franchises you love most, from Madden to The Simpsons Tapped Out. But that's not all. I'm excited to announce that later this year, we're bringing you a brand new CCG role-playing game, Star Wars Galaxy of Heroes. We believe this is the Star Wars game mobile players have been waiting for, loaded with characters you know and love. From the prequels and classic trilogies to the Clone Wars and more, it's a massive game that spans the entire Star Wars universe. You can collect, battle, and dominate with your favorite Star Wars characters and ships. And finally, let's welcome Mike Rasmussen to show you a little bit of Minions Paradise.
Nice. Thank you. Few characters in the world are as delightfully flawed and truly original as the Minions. I mean, seriously, who has not dreamed of having an army of these little guys? Well, through an unprecedented creative partnership with Illumination Entertainment, we're bringing that fantasy to life. Minions Paradise is a builder game that introduces you to Phil, a sweet yet subversive minion who's exclusive to the game.
Hide your bananas! The minions are on the vacation of their lives! And what fun! There's Charlie and his balloon animals! Barry and his famous burritos! Ken and his delicious cakes! Ah, and Phil. He usually ruins everything. Hey, Phil, maybe you can keep to yourself here. Do some harmless sunbathing. Oh, no! Phil! Look what you've done. Your buddies are furious that you've ruined their awesome vacation. You better do something quick. I think you'll need to do a little more than that.
All right, let's take a look at the game.
Hello.
Hi, Phil. First things first, what paradise would be complete without a tiki lounge? And Phil loves his tiki lounge. Check it out, Phil. Now, the Tiki Lounge becomes a focal point for the game, where you'll get quests and check in on Phil and his progress. Maybe this will help him win over his pals. Well, here come Phil's buddies, but they're still angry. Phil better act quick, so he gets the party started with some coconut drinks. But now he's out of coconuts. Hey, Phil, send your buddies out for more. What could go wrong, right? Well, with the minions, pretty much anything can go wrong. We always want you to be surprised and delighted by the trouble the minions get into. And we worked hand in hand with Illumination to create these unexpected moments that make this world come to life. I love that. You combine items in the island to create things that every minion needs, like throwing stars or swamp gas grenades. And you'll explore the island to find new activities to keep your minions' vacation going, like this water slide. Or fishing, which quickly goes haywire when an alligator snaps the bait and suddenly you're water skiing. We give you a blank canvas to create your own minions' paradise, and we can't wait for you to play this later this year. With endless surprises and chances to play with your minions, this is a vacation you'll never forget. And that's Minions Paradise. Thank you.
Pelé.
He's certainly head and shoulders above any other striker.
For me, the best player ever.
Football is in my heart, in my feet, in my body, in my soul. It has power like no other sport. It lifts an entire nation. It has the power to take our breath away. To make us laugh, cry, and rejoice. I've scored over 1,000 goals. The only player to win 3 World Cups. Voted player of the century. My legacy? To be the man that created more moments of beauty than anybody else. Will my beauty ever be matched? We will see.
It's Pelé! Pelé now! That's the infrastructure for Barca!
And Pelé!
Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest football player of all time, Pelé!
Obrigado.
Everything okay?
All right, man.
My pleasure.
Come on in. Can you believe it? So I've got a really sore face. We've been spending a bit of time chatting, and my face has been grinning too much. Anyway, we wanted to get you here because you've got some amazing stories to tell. And you told me one earlier today about when you went to New York and how you coined the phrase, the beautiful game. Would you share it with everyone here?
No, first of all, thank you for the beautiful welcome. That is the family of the sport, a family of football. Thank you. When we started to promote the soccer in the United States, I come from New York Cosmos, and then we used to practice with the giant stage, yep. the American football there, and then some players say, "Oh, this is a beautiful game." I say, "No, the beautiful game, the jogo bonito, is soccer. Soccer is jogo bonito. American football." Then I say, "American football." It's too much bumpy, too much struggle. Soccer is more intelligent. I started to tease my friends from New York. Then that's the reason we say the jogo bonito become known, the beautiful game. It's a beautiful.
So I wanted everyone to hear that story, because for me it's an amazing tale about how that phrase kind of came about to represent football or soccer. Yeah. And we really wanted to kind of take that idea of the expression and flair from the game of football and put it into FIFA, which is what the team have been working on this year. But the other thing I really wanted to ask you about is, when you think about those moments, those beautiful moments in the game of football, and think about recent matches, what do you think of? What thing springs to mind?
No, first of all, we have to be known very careful when you see the game, when you was in the game.
Yeah.
Because when you stay in the game, as I have my 25 years there, lot of emotion, lot of thing happen, you know? I think I told you about I score a lot of goal, bicycle. It's a beautiful bicycle kick, you know? When you dribble one, two, but the most difficult goals who I scored in my life was the penalty kick. you know?
Yeah, you said about
it. You remember? I'm going to tell for the youngest. When I scored 1,000 goals, was a big party, you know, whole Brazil waited. I thought, okay, oh God, maybe I'm going to make go by head, go by bicycle, beautiful goal. Then it was a penalty kick. But it was more difficult, you know, moment in my life, because I put the ball in a mark. Then I start, oh my God, I cannot miss. I cannot miss. It was a penalty kick, but it was more difficult for me. So I think this is what the game bring to you, because it's no different moment, you know.
Awesome. I mean, again, just that idea of depending on the situation or the circumstance, the fact that's what makes it beautiful.
Yeah.
It can be a single moment, or it could be everything strung together. Yeah,
depending on the moment. For example, I have in my career, I have a lot of moments. You know? For example, my first World Cup, I was with 16 years old to 17. You know? In Brazil, you know, play... No, in Sweden, and it was everything new for us. You know, even when we traveled to Sweden, you know, when I get there, my first traveling outside of Brazil, 16 years old, I went there. The girls from Sweden, the blonde girl, she started to put them on my hair. I didn't understand well, you know, my older players, because we have interpreted. It was the different, you know, emotion, because it was completely different. Fortunately, Brazil won the World Cup, you know. I was 17. It was a different moment, you know.
Amazing. So I think we could probably sit here forever. You talk about beautiful moments. This is a really beautiful moment for me personally. Thank you so much for coming here. I'm sure everyone is amazed you. By this. Thank you.
That keeps the ball rolling.
What a legend.
Thank you. Thank you.
You take care.
Thank you.
Take care.
Okay.
Thank you.
Nice to you.
That was kind of unbelievable. But you know, we do have to actually get on and start to talk about the beautiful game in FIFA 16. Because gameplay's always been the soul of FIFA. This year, obviously, we want to innovate across the entire pitch. We have tons of innovations in our gameplay this year, but we also want to help you compete at a higher level and also give you new ways to play. And each of these massive pillars within the game has been built with the millions of FIFA fans out there in mind. So let's get to the pitch and see the most balanced FIFA yet. When playing the game, you want confidence in defense. You want to be able to defend with purpose and backbone. So in FIFA 16, all new defensive agility gives you the mobility you need to track skilled players, especially when they're on the break. And teams really win when they defend as a unit. So this year, you'll have better defensive shape on the pitch to help break down attacks and counter-attack when you win the ball. And in the middle of the pitch, you'll control the midfield, the battleground of any great match. Interception intelligence helps shut down options and close dangerous passing channels. And on the counter, passing with purpose lets you play sharp passes to slice through defenders. It's now a more considered build-up through the midfield, with more options than ever before. And in the final third, you want more moments of magic, more skills, better dribbling, all so you can create menacing attacks. And sometimes the best touch is the one that you don't take. So we've captured the movement of today's best player to bring you no-touch dribbling. Free yourself from the ball to buy time. Create separation and blow by your defender, just as Messi does when he's at his best. It's near limitless creativity and changes the game profoundly. And when you're in on goal, clinical finishing helps you create those wow moments only FIFA can deliver. From box to box, from sideline to sideline, we're innovating across literally every inch of the pitch so you can play your way. And for every fan, we're giving you the ability to compete at a higher level. Whether you're new to FIFA or play every season, FIFA Trainer will help dial up your game no matter your level. The controller language you see here on screen will change as you move around the pitch and bring you options sure to help you play better defense, make better passes, and hopefully score more goals. And this year, finally, we're giving you an amazing new way to play. For the first time ever in the FIFA franchise, women's teams are in the game. We've been working on this for years, and it's at the level of authenticity that FIFA's known for, thanks to our motion capture technology and our body and facial scanning. And our gameplay engine and physics engine give us the right platform to build out player-specific models and animations specific to the best female athletes in the world. It's huge news for the franchise and something myself and the FIFA team are immensely proud of. So, a balanced experience across the whole game, innovation across the entire pitch, complete at a higher level, and new ways to play. And that's just the start. We have news on the rest of the game throughout the summer as we continue to make FIFA 16 a beautiful experience. And finally, I know it's unforgettable, I just want to remind you that Pelé was on stage with me about 3 minutes ago. How crazy was that? But now, to commemorate this huge moment, along with Pelé and our friend Leo Messi, we're dropping a special item into the account of all our loyal FIFA 15 Ultimate Team players. So go check it out at the end of the press conference. And let's take a look at the beautiful game in FIFA 16.
Beautiful football. The game played by the entire planet. The game that brings us together. The game made up of many faces. But the beauty is in the moments. Powerful. Suspenseful. Stunning. Spine tingling. but for as much beauty as I have created, for as much beauty as I have experienced. I know, I have seen nothing yet. What is beauty if you cannot experience it? 16. Play beautiful.
What would life be like if we willingly gave away our privacy? What would our world look like if there were no governments, only corporations? Who would save us from our oppressors, from ourselves? Could a young girl without any superpowers be a catalyst for change? These are questions you may ask yourselves, and these are the questions that inspired us as we set out to bring Mirror's Edge to a new generation of gamers. Welcome to Mirror's Edge Catalyst. This is a revolutionary action-adventure game where you will experience the origin story of our heroine, Faith. From a careless young woman to a fierce heroine who opens the eyes of an entire city. She's not your usual video game hero. And because this is a truly immersive first-person experience, you're not just watching the events unfold in front of you. You are Faith. She is graceful, elegant, and as efficient as she is powerful. She doesn't need any guns. Faith combines her momentum, martial arts combat, and her mastery of the environment. This environment is the City of Glass, built on the latest version of our Frostbite engine. It's beautiful and stylized. But behind the beautiful facade lies a dark truth. The city is ruled by the corporations, led by this man, Gabriel Kruger. There is no individual freedom. There is no privacy. You will uncover these secrets as you explore the city on your terms. There's plenty for you to do, and we're giving you the freedom of choice. There are story missions, activities like time trials and races, and environmental puzzles. Most importantly, there are no levels, there are no loading screens. You are truly free roaming. Fluid movement and combat in first person. Running free in a beautiful, massive city. Experiencing the rise of Faith. This is her origin story. And for those of you here at E3, you can come by and play it for yourself at the EA booth. Here's the world premiere of Mirror's Edge Catalyst, captured fully in engine, coming February 23rd, 2016.
Every new day holds a promise.
Faith, I'm scared!
Where are you?
You can waste it, or spend it advancing yourself. A productive employee is a happy employee. Anyone can rise to high caste level. Your possibilities are infinite. Personal freedom comes at a price. Be wary of policy breakers in our midst.
With Kruger, but I got something for it.
I'm taking her out.
I don't like what's coming, Faith. This city is changing, and not for the better. Unless, of course, we stop it.
You on the ground now!
Go on, girl. Save us all.
With the 42nd pick in the 2010 NFL Drafts, the New England Patriots select Rob Gronkowski, tight end, Arizona.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sean Grady, senior producer for Madden NFL.
Sean, that was a great example of how the New England Patriots drafted the right players in the right round and the right playmakers to build their current Super Bowl championship team. Hi, everyone. I'm Robert Flores. I'm host of ESPN2's Fantasy Football Now. And spending time on the set all these years, I've learned two things. One, my hair looks great on the big screen, and that 40 million fantasy sports fans out there would say that their favorite part of playing fantasy football is the ability to draft their own team.
Okay, well, we've got something really exciting for those fantasy fans. It's called Draft Champions, and it's a brand new way to get the fantasy draft experience every day. Now, Draft Champions puts you in your own personal war room, starting your playmaker journey off the field. We built this mode for both our Madden players and the fantasy fanatics who love the excitement that come with drafting a fantasy team. And Madden mobile players, don't sleep on this. It's a great reason to check out the console experience. Now, it's similar to Madden Mobile and Ultimate Team. You'll build a current team, a team of current and legendary players. But what really sets Draft Champions apart is the fun, fast, multi-round draft. You're going to get three players to choose from in each round, so every draft is exciting and different. It's all about interesting decisions and how you choose to build your team. Now, Robert, we final three rounds of your draft here. All right. Let's see how you, a fantasy football expert, handled it. All right. So I see right away you're still short a quarterback. You haven't upgraded yet.
Well, sometimes, like I do in real fantasy football, I'll wait on getting a quarterback. I wanted a defensive back, DRC, a new member of the New York Giants. I went with him.
Okay, that's a great pick. A little risky leaving a quarterback in that late round. Now, this next round is probably your most difficult. A lot of great players on the board. What'd you decide here?
Absolutely. Look, any fan would love to get Jamal Charles with all his home run speed on their team. And then you got J.J. Watt, the reigning defensive player of the year, on their defensive line. But I don't know how you turned down the best receiver in the league for my money, Calvin Johnson, so I'm pumped to have Megatron on my roster.
Okay, I'm a little surprised to see you leave J.J. Watt on the board from your Houston Texans.
They are my team.
But not a bad pick. All right, in this final round, legends all over the board here. We all love legends. What'd you decide?
Well, look, you got the obvious quarterback choice there, but you got a couple of Hall of Famers. You got Derek Brooks and John Randall, exceptional defenders. But in the end, I needed that quarterback, so I go Randall Cunningham. He's got the big arm and the perfect fit to throw that ball downfield to Megatron. So okay. I went with Randall Cunningham.
Looks like a really solid draft there, a good team. If not, a little lucky with that quarterback coming in the final round. Worked out well. All right, once you've nailed the draft, this is where Madden takes fantasy to another level. Instead of passively watching the guys you drafted play, you get to be the playmaker on the field. You play with your team solo other players to see how your draft and your game stack up. And once you've completed your mini season, you'll be back at the drafting board to start a whole new run. One quick experience, something you could frankly do in a night.
That is awesome. Very cool. I know where a lot of fantasy fans and fantasy football players this season will be spending their time.
All right, well, we couldn't agree more. Robert, we appreciate you being out here as the fantasy expert voice today. Let's give a big round of applause for Robert Flores.
This was outstanding. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Okay, today's NFL is a passing league. So we've overhauled the entire passing game. Whether you're Odell Beckham Jr. making a gravity-defying catch or Patrick Peterson intercepting the ball for a game-winning touchdown, playmakers dominate the passing game on both sides of the ball. So we focused on three key positions: quarterbacks, receivers, and defenders in coverage. Let's start with quarterback. New body relative throws give you the chance to lead your tall receivers high above a defender's reach. Or throw low on a curl route to wall off the defender, protecting both the ball and your receiver. As an example,
If Russell Wilson would have used a body relative low throw to end the Super Bowl, we'd probably be referring to the Seahawks as the two-time defending champs. Now, catches in the NFL never cease to amaze me. They're one of the most exciting and dynamic plays in any sport. As a receiver, you can now choose from one of three new catch types to beat the competition and keep your drive alive. First, a possession catch will increase your chance of a completion to get that critical first down, but might sacrifice yards. Next, a rack or run after catch. Adjust your route so you can attempt to gain extra yards after the catch. And finally, use an aggressive catch to attack the ball at its highest point. And I know what you're thinking, now the game is all about offense. But don't worry, we didn't forget about defense. As a defender in coverage, going for the interception or swat can be risky. For the first time, now you'll have the ability to play the receiver instead of just the ball. You can make an attempt to secure the tackle or use the new play receiver mechanic to execute a well-timed hit, dislodging the ball and preventing the catch. Madden NFL 16 is delivering tools so you can be the playmaker on the field as a quarterback, receiver, and defender in coverage. And with Draft Champions, you'll start your playmaker journey off the field in this exciting new fantasy-inspired mode. You'll have your first shot to prove you're the playmaker both on and off the field right here at E3, or for those of you at home when the game launches on August 25th. Now, let's take a look at the official Madden 16 E3 trailer.
Every now and then, someone comes along and changes everything.
The high-powered Packers have proven why they're at the top of the NFC. Cobb with a go-ahead score, that could mean the dagger for the Giants.
But finding them is easier said than done.
The Giants have been lackluster in two-minute drills all year. Can this be the one that changes their season? Manning drops back. He's tackled for a sack.
And at times, it seems hopeless.
No timeouts left. Could this be the last play of the game? The Giants need a touchdown.
Until you realize that there is an opportunity to do more. And in this very moment, you discover.
It's caught! Odell Beckham Jr.
It was you all along. Be the playmaker in Madden NFL 16.
Through my decade and a half in this industry, I've learned that every once in a great while, you can be part of something special. This is one of those moments. In the past 2.5 years, we put some of EA's greatest talent and most advanced technology together with one of the most beloved sagas of our time, as we seek to create something that millions of fans around the world will love. The passion, creativity, and dedication come from our DICE studio in Stockholm. The technology is EA's own Frostbite game engine. And the game is, of course, Star Wars Battlefront. Now, Frostbite powers many of the games you've seen here today. Looking ahead, Frostbite will be at the core of even more EA games, including experiences for mobile devices, and maybe, one day, even VR. Right now, the sophistication of Frostbite is bringing a galaxy far, far away to life like never before. In just a few moments, you'll see how tools like physically based rendering, new weathering systems, and a technique called photogrammetry are being used to create an incredibly detailed, immersive, and completely authentic experience in Star Wars Battlefront. We're still only beginning to see what Frostbite can truly achieve. But the results are completely stunning. So let us show you, made by developers that love Star Wars, for fans that love Star Wars, let's step into the world of Star Wars Battlefront.
I'm Sigurlína Ingvarsdóttir, and I have the awesome job of leading a talented, passionate team at DICE on Star Wars Battlefront. Like many of you, I can't remember a time when Star Wars wasn't a part of my life. And one of my earliest memories is of seeing a dark, ominous being that I was terrified of. That being, whose mask still has the ability to strike fear in me, is Darth Vader. I remember playing with the old action figures or attaching a clothespin to a magic marker to create a blaster pistol so that I could run around shooting lasers at imaginary stormtroopers. Today, by far the best place to truly lose yourself and interact with Star Wars is video games. With Star Wars Battlefront, we will immerse players in an incredibly authentic, visually stunning universe. And we've gotten amazing access from our partners at Lucasfilm. They've opened up their sacred vaults to us so that we can recreate the props and locations from the original trilogy. When you fly in an X-Wing, it's the real X-Wing. We will give you the chance to live out the Star Wars battle fantasies you've always dreamed of, and we can't wait to see all of the new memories you will create on your own. We have a great amount of depth. A variety of multiplayer modes that range from large-scale battles between 40 players all the way down to 8-player modes that deliver a more intimate experience between squads of Rebel and Imperial soldiers. Have you ever wanted to fly an X-Wing? Soaring above the skies, skimming the rims of canyons on Tatooine while you dogfight against a squad of TIE fighters? Or have you fantasized about being one of the most iconic heroes or villains in the Star Wars universe? Wielding a lightsaber and using the Force, being the boss of a multiplayer match, and single-handedly turning the tide of an epic Star Wars battle. And if you're not in the mood for multiplayer, we have Star Wars Battlefront missions where you can jump in and play against AI, alone or with a friend, including split-screen co-op and one-on-one battles. Now, it's been 2 months since we revealed Star Wars Battlefront, and we've been amazed by the response. But if there's one thing that's come through, loud and clear, is that you want to see gameplay. So that's what we're going to do right now. What we're about to show you today is Walker Assault, one of our largest modes. This mode was inspired by the Battle of Hoth from The Empire Strikes Back. As the Empire, you must escort AT-AT walkers towards the Rebel base to destroy it. And as the Rebels, you must do everything you can to stop them. And while you will see a lot of things that remind you of that iconic battle, when you play the game your way, anything is possible. This was all captured on a PlayStation 4, and you will see the battle from the vantage point of both the Empire and the Rebels. Now, let's play Star Wars.
Soldier down! Hold on.
Rebels have activated the uplink station. We must shut it down.
Incoming fire! Fall back!
Incoming orbital strike!
Going in. This is Blue 12 accelerating to attack speed.
The walker is exposed. Focus all firepower on it.
Bombers are making their attack run.
Go in for the takedown. Almost there.
Taken out.
Yes! Walker down! TIE fighter incoming!
Omega 15 going in.
Making that attack run.
Star Wars Battlefront, coming November 17th. That's our show for today. For those of you here in LA, we'll see you at our booth where everything is hands-on and ready to play. If you're joining us on the web, visit livetoplay.ea.com where we'll have more behind-the-scenes content and stories. Thanks to all of our awesome teams, thanks to Palais, and thanks to all of you for joining us. Have a great show, everyone, and wherever you are, we hope you make some time to play. Thank you.
That's a wrap for EA's press conference here at E3 2015, and we are going to round it up with our three highlights. I think we are all pretty much in agreement of the games that we really enjoyed there.
Mm-hmm.
Mirror's Edge, Mass
yes.
Effect, and Star Wars Battlefront. Let's start,
at the start, I guess.
Yeah.
Mass Effect.
Let's go for it. It's Mass Effect Andromeda, revealed in a trailer right at the beginning.
If you notice, like in the pre-show, we said Andromeda about five times.
I think that is a conservative estimate. You guys were saying that for a long time. But yes, there it is. We got a glimpse at sort of a Mass Effect N7 character swiping through a bunch of concept art. But this actually looks like it's, I mean, it's a teaser trailer, right? But this is sort of transitions into the navigation module.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then I think those were the concept worlds that we got to see last year as well, when they were showing conceptual prototypes of the worlds they were kind of creating.
One of them had a sky whale, or just some giant creature floating through space. So definitely going to see some new creatures in action, of course.
I love the redesign of the N7 armor. Yeah. I've got to say, it looks more alien, if anything.
How so?
Can you not see? I don't know, just the way it's jutting out and not entirely conforming to the shape of whatever New Shepard is.
And
you know,
we're going to get a glimpse of it, yeah. Actually, so in that moment, sort of the jetpack scramble, and now in this moment coming up, the armor does look, there's sort of a more nimble kind of gameplay. I mean, you know, you could always run as Shepard, but this ground pound here, there's sort of, it feels like a little bit more of a kinetic focus on the hero's mobility.
And in that part as well, you could hear a Reaper sound effect when those kind of building things were moving.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe hinting, because the Reaper, that's the thing. It's like they can't pull a Daleks on it and keep bringing the Reapers back at every single opportunity. But I'd like to think there was some kind of Reaper influence,
some kind of connection to the technology. Yeah. You know, because as we learned from the Protheans in Mass Effect, that the old technology is just kind of around.
Yeah.
And has weird influences on the different species of people that find it.
Are you surprised we didn't see any gameplay?
Well, for Holiday 2016?
Yeah.
Yeah. No. I mean, I think we all thought, or at least hoped, that it was further along in development than it was.
Yeah.
I can wait.
I can wait. And it does look absolutely beautiful, doesn't
it? Was that enough to give you a little wait? You know, like, okay, yeah, it's coming. It looks pretty cool. I'm down.
We can just wait. It'll be fine.
How about that Mako, or whatever the version of it that they're talking
about?
That thing was quick. That was like creepy insect quick. You know, when you see an insect move and you're like, no, you shouldn't be able to do that.
You shouldn't be able to go that fast.
That was fast.
It reminded me a little of the, because they did have the speedy, was it the Firewalker in Mass Effect 2? It was like a DLC like thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it was speedy, but obviously it was it floated off the ground. So this looks like the best of both worlds. Or it's tanky and yet nimble.
Mm-hmm.
Very exciting. Mass Effect Andromeda, that's our first look. Got it just at the EA press conference here at E3 2015. Next up, Mirror's Edge Catalyst. We got to see some gameplay of that one in action. And it's not the whitewashed, red highlighted world necessarily. The sort of city seems to have been fleshed out aesthetically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was actually writing a news story when this was on, so I didn't actually get to see it. So if you guys could describe it for me, that would be... Just describe it for everyone. What did it...
Why don't you look at this trailer?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Better yet, yeah.
Right
here
on cue.
So you see the kind of cues that are, you know, the scuff marks, the red walls that are sort of visual cues to help you maintain your speed, that thing that made Mirror's Edge so... like it made it you able to have that kind of momentum through the world. Of course, we see some combat with Faith kicking some ass later on, but... the woman presenting made mention that Faith doesn't use guns.
Yeah.
And
awesome.
So she doesn't, like, use them, but she used them in Mirror's Edge.
In the original, you could. But you also, I think you were rewarded if you did, like, a pacifist playthrough and didn't use them at all. So it's interesting.
Do you think you'll be able to use them, or is it just going to go pure punchy-kicky this time around?
Maybe she just hasn't learned how to use them yet. Because you can't, you know, just pick up a gun and just...
Or maybe they are doing that slash and burn on the story. There was a lot of different... If you've played the first Mirror's Edge, I won't say anything for spoilers, but there are a lot of small moments in this trailer that sort of indicated to me that we're getting a new look at the story, I think, or a reboot on the story.
You like that? You like getting a reboot? Yeah. I think it seems smart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And let's talk a little bit about the fact that it is now completely open.
Yeah.
There are no levels... It's just complete free roam, no loading screens.
Wow.
That's the real
I mean, that's
dream,
pretty incredible, right? So you think about sort of an open world, right? And then, how do you sort of gate players' progress? Because there's always some kind of mechanic, whether the enemies in a certain area are just too formidable or whether you need to get to a certain story beat to unlock this area. So you can imagine that it's just because it's an open world doesn't mean you can go everywhere right from the start, but it certainly implies a kind of freedom and broad sort of what's the word? You know, like options in terms of way you can approach a given situation.
And certainly that was the dream of the original game, at least, right? You wanted that level of freedom. And I think it's really commendable that EA are trying their best in rebooting this franchise. I think a lot of people love the original Mirror's Edge. It kind of fell short a little bit in terms of critical response and sales. But so I think they're doing a great job in just trying to restore it. I think it's cool.
Yeah, keeping the visual identity and sort of the aesthetic identity, but then also giving nods that, yeah, this is a new take on Mirror's Edge for a new generation of consoles. That's Mirror's Edge Catalyst, shown off the EA press conference here at E3 2015. And then, of course, the EA press conference ended with Star Wars Battlefront, as promised. CEO Andrew House said it right from the beginning. And we've known we were going to get gameplay ever since the reveal. And lo and behold, the battle on Ice Planet Hoth.
I was shaking. I was actually trembling throughout the whole thing. It was so good. I mean, everything about it was exceptional. I loved it so much.
All right, give me one thing about it that was stood out in particular.
I think it was the scope of the battle. So you could go into AT-ATs or AT-ATs, however you want to pronounce
it. It's AT-AT.
Well, not according to Wikipedia, okay?
We'll talk about it later.
Because then what do you call ATSTs?
All right,
that's the thing.
We are not arguing Star Wars canon here. This is not that show. Go down that rabbit hole. You never come out.
This game is so not canon anyway.
It's
just can't shoot cannons.
Just flying in ships, commanding different vehicles, having Jedi powers, seeing Darth Vader on the battlefield. Everything about it, I thought they absolutely nailed. And I can't wait to play this game. It looks incredible.
It's a beautiful looking game. This is the impression I got when we got to see the gameplay demo at Star Wars Celebration, was just the environmental detail was rich. Like, look at the stuff on the rocks. So just that kind of detailing really pops in a way that it doesn't feel distracting. It just feels enriching to the whole environment. All those footprints in the snow. Yeah. Mm.
So they said that DICE have been working with a process called photogrammetry.
Yes.
Which is just basically you take a buttload of photos of something like a cliff face and then feed it into a program. And it spits out these really realistic looking models you can just plonk straight into the game. Mm. And it's clear that it just, like, it's helping the game look fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
It's such a great development tool. And I guess more games are going to be using it now. But it just, the whole game, it just looks great.
It looks so good. And we saw some vehicles in action here, of course, a TIE fighter. There's also X-Wing flight. These, of course, are only in atmosphere. They've announced that there are no space battles in Star Wars Battlefront. Also, I think I misspoke on the pre-show. 40 players is the cap that they've announced, not the 32 that I mentioned. So
this.
20 per side. But
And the changing of perspectives, right, between third person and first person, cockpit and out of ship view, just incredible.
And they do that in a ship, they do that in the AT-AT, they do that and you do that on foot, and you can do that at will, at any point in time, depending on how you prefer to play or what you think will give you a situational advantage, or if you just, in this case, want to take a look at your sick green mohawk.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Heck yeah. Oh.
We're coming up to, like, this was my favorite moment, I think, just when the guy turns around and just sees that his buddy is just... Oh, yeah, we're coming up to it now.
One of those nicely scripted moments. Yeah. But yeah, so you...
The shield moment was really cool as well.
Oh, yeah.
The sound effects.
Yep, and that's, you know, part of the sort of different character class customization.
Uh-oh.
Bill, no!
Why are they looking at an ally?
Bill, wait.
You're having a neck problem,
no.
Eh, buddy?
Oh,
there
no.
he is. Look at that. Was so
This
incredible.
Is so fan service, and I just love it. Look at that pout they've got going.
That's
that's
as well.
That's full-on turtleneck Skywalker
this
right
there.
This
is exciting. I like that Battlefront is letting you... I know a lot of people are like, oh, like, it breaks the immersion if you have Darth Vader in the battlefield. You know what? I like playing with canon. Where else could you do this?
I'm running up to him. That's
boom.
Amazing.
This is such a great moment.
Absolutely.
That
gets
me giddy with excitement there.
Playing as those hero characters, definitely something in Battlefront's history that's been wonderful. They're bringing it back in a big way. And Battlefront's coming out this fall.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys excited?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Play some
Star
Wars?
1 week after Fallout and Tomb Raider.
It's going to be a busy month.
Wow, what a
month.
Yikes.
It's going to be real busy.
Embarrassment of riches, hopefully, as all these games turn out to be as exciting as we're hoping they will be. Thank you, folks, so much for joining us for our EA post-conference pre- and post-show. Coming up next is the Ubisoft press conference in just about 20 minutes. We're going to take a break, and we're going to be back to stream that press conference to you live, and we'll be back with a post-show analysis following to talk about all the highlights there, all the stuff they hit, all the new IP they hopefully unveil, and more excitement here from E3 2015.